Hey guys, it's June 12th, 2015. I'm Reginald, also known as Dimcat. Looks like ObamaTrade is dead in the U.S. Congress. President Obama wanted to give himself fast-track authority in dealing with trade deals. He wanted to be able to work up trade deals with other countries and present the deals to Congress, and Congress could either reject it or approve it, support it or reject it, but Congress would not be able to amend it. Well, his plan went down in flames. Congress decided not to go that route. The union put a lot of pressure on a lot of Democrats. People within his own party actually voted against this. Nancy Pelosi, well, obviously wasn't very supportive. It shows that the union still has a little power in this country. They still have a lot of power in this country, even though they've been weakened over the years. This deal went down in flames, and other presidents apparently had similar powers, similar authorities. But at this point, I think he's wasted so much political collateral that he's not going to have much success in getting much done in his second term. I think that's one of the costs of Obamacare. The two Republican minority candidates, Ben Carson and Mark Rubio, had a pretty rough week this week. Ben Carson was basically portrayed by the U.S. media as a multi-marketing scammer, a guy who promoted a multi-marketing operation, and he's being portrayed as somebody who's supporting the 21st century equivalent of tonic, magical tonic. You know, some company was supposedly selling some stuff that would that they declared to be a cure for a lot of different things, and there's a lot of reports that Ben Carson acted as a spokesman for this. You know, that's not really the big story. The issue is that the media is targeting this guy when, you know, he's doing well in some polls. He's the black guy running as a Republican in a presidential field for 2016, but I don't think he has a viable chance of winning. And it's interesting how the media is targeting this guy. You know, I mean, they're so afraid of any minority doing well in a Republican Party. It's kind of funny. You know, but anyway, it's interesting how this guy was targeted pretty quickly by the mainstream media, especially those on the left. And Mark Rubio, who, you know, justifiably he should have been targeted. Mark Rubio. Apparently, the New York Times put out an article showing a little bit of his financial past. They're showing that he had a tremendous amount of debt, and even when he had a lot of debt, he was out buying speedboats. I mean, which raises a lot of questions. I think it's a smear piece, but it raises some legitimate questions. You know, if you have debt, what are you doing buying stuff like that? It's important. It's important, even if it's coming from people on the left. The fact of the matter is, if you want to be president and you're claiming to be fiscally conservative or at least fiscally responsible, you have to be able to do that in your own finances. I mean, that's part of, you know, talking the talk and walking the walk. You can't just talk the talk. You got to walk the walk. Either way, I thought it was interesting. You know, obviously he's a Cuban. He's a Latino or a Cuban. So he's being targeted by the Republican Party. Ted Cruz, a lot of liberals in the establishment. I don't think Ted Cruz is somebody that anybody's really worried about. I don't think anybody on the left is really worried about him. I don't really take him seriously. He's good with the right-wing crowds, but that does not make him a presidential contender. That doesn't make him a viable candidate for president. Okay? You have to have a vision, you have to have a plan, and you have to have the means to make it a reality. Okay, and I just think he's a talk artist. But, you know, I could be wrong. That's just my initial impression of these guys. All right, all last year, in 2014, I told you guys about the subprime loans in the car market. And essentially, as cars become more and more expensive, more and more people are borrowing money to pay for these cars that they cannot afford, and they're borrowing for longer periods of time, right? Well, I'm looking at this article called "More Auto Title Lenders Are Snagging Unwary Borrowers in Cycle of Debt." First of all, these are adults here. These aren't children, okay? How can they be adults and be this stupid? Okay, look, this article pointed out a guy by the name of Jordan. Could have been a woman, actually. As a woman, as a female by the name of Jordan. She's 58 years old. She said she needed $400 to help her pay for her bills, including cable TV and other expenses. First of all, why the hell are you subscribe to cable TV if you can't afford it. First of all, I think cable TV is a terrible idea anyway, unless you have a big family and people who like to watch TV. It just seems like a complete scam to me. It doesn't make any sense. It's a stupid bill to have. You can replace that with Netflix and Hulu, or it doesn't make any sense to pay $180 for the internet, the cable TV, and the phone, and all this other crap, when you can just pay $50 or $60 for the internet and go ahead and get Netflix and Hulu. But anyway, I digress. 58 years old, this woman, Jordan, said she needed $400, a $400 loan, and she went to one of those get cash when you need it type of places. Okay, Allied Cash Advance, which, by the way, is always a terrible idea. I know people who have gone to these cash advance places, and it's always a terrible idea. The interest rates for this stuff is ridiculous. And if you have to go to a cash advance place, then you're making a bad decision. Like, one time I went there to actually cash a check, and it charged me it wasn't too bad, but people only go there when they're desperate, and you shouldn't make financial decisions when you're desperate. So I try to avoid places like that. I recommend that people avoid places like that. Okay, I'm not trying to speak as some type of wannabe financial expert. I'm just speaking as somebody who has seen people struggle even more than I've struggled. Okay, so anyway, she tried to get this loan for $400, and they told her that essentially they're not going to give her a loan that small. Of course not, because they want to charge her an incredible amount of interest. They want more. They want her to be more and more in debt, so they get more and more money. Anyway, instead, they would lend her $2,600 with an equivalent annual interest of 153%. Wow. As long as she put up her 2005 Buick Rendezvous SUV as collateral. Are you kidding me? You only need $400, so why are you willing to put up your vehicle, your transportation, something you need to get to work, as collateral for a loan that you don't really need? This woman is 58 years old. You know, why would a company want to do that anyway? Is it predatory? Of course it is. But the woman's 58 years old. 58 years old. How could she be? That's stupid. Anyway, in California, the number of auto title loans has jumped to 91,505 in 2013. Okay, that's the latest data available. It jumped from 64,558. So about from 65,000 in 2012 or so to 91,000 in 2013. And check this out. In 2011, that number was around 38. So it went from 38,000 to 65,000 to 91,000. Is the economy really doing that much better in California that all these people feel like is justified and sign up for more of these loans? And the thing is, a lot of these people don't even have good credit, and they're signing up for this stuff. I mean, to me, when you take out a car loan, not only are you saying that that you're betting, not only are you making a commitment, and by the way, the average car loan is now, what, 6 years for the new vehicle, 6 to 7 years, which is incredible. It's basically saying that you're going to make a 6 to 7 year commitment to an appliance with wheels. I mean, come on, that's basically what a car is. Too many people look at a car as, oh, a status symbol. It's an appliance with freaking wheels. It's a freaking 6 to 7 year commitment for a freaking car. Not only are you making a huge commitment, but you're also making a huge bet. You're betting that for the next 6 or 7 years, you're going to be gainfully employed. And that's contingent on the economy being good for 6 to 7 years. That's contingent on your job being secure enough for you to hold on for 6 to 7 years to make these payments. When if you lose your job? What other bills do you have? You still have to pay that payment, and so many people go by the payments. They don't look at the interest that they're going to have to pay. It's absolutely insane. Like, you're willing to make that bet? Some people are in a good financial position, but a lot of people are not. You're going to bet for 6 to 7 years that you're going to be able to keep paying off on this vehicle. That's why I wanted to hurry up and get rid of my debt. I didn't even want to go into it at all, but anyway. So basically, in March, I got a car, paid $2,800 down on a vehicle that costs overall $6,900. With the interest, it was $7,200. And then I basically pay $600 per paycheck, $1,200 per month. And here I am, I'm pretty much down to the last $1,500 or so. I'm going to have this whole thing paid off by the end of July. To me, that's a long-term commitment. For me, I couldn't even see myself going a whole year making a commitment, but like this to a freaking car. Not that I'm recommending people do that. If you can, pay in cash. That's what I would recommend. Matter of fact, if you're thinking about getting another vehicle, a used vehicle, start saving up now. Even if you think it's a year from now. If you're not thinking about getting a new vehicle, start saving up now. That way, when you start to think about getting a new vehicle and something breaks down, you're thinking, oh, crap, I got to get a new vehicle. You'll have some money put aside. That's my plan. Anyway, guys, thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. What do you think about all this car debt? All this auto loan debt is, it's incredible. People are trying to keep up with the Joneses, trying to make themselves feel better by driving something new that they can't afford. More than 2 million people per year, on average, take out car loans. A lot of them are taking loans out on vehicles they can't afford. Anyway, I came across a pretty interesting article called Billionaire Bunkers. It's an exclusive look inside the world's largest planned doomsday escape. Now, I'm pretty sure this doesn't involve a situation where, you know, the atmosphere is wiped out or anything like that, but maybe nuclear war or something like that. And these bunkers look like resorts. I mean, they're pretty impressive. I like the layout. I've been doing a lot of research on home security, so a lot of this stuff seems to be pretty impressive, although I would make some changes. They actually have these one bunker in an actual mountain, and they actually have a metal wall, well, not a metal wall, a concrete wall, probably reinforced with rebar or something, and some lights and some barbed wire at the very top. I hope the wall goes deep into the ground. You know, but for a facility like that, the key is that nobody knows where it's at. I mean, that's one of the biggest things, you know, because the people want to get in. They know where you're at, and they want to get in bad enough. They can get in. You need a whole lot of resources to keep people out, and I'm learning that about home security and burglaries and things like that. But can you imagine having a pretty cool bunker set up, and you're married with kids, and her in-laws show up? So, like, how do you tell your wife that, hey, I don't want your in-laws showing up if the bombs start to drop? I mean, because if we have to rebuild civilization or whatever, I don't want to be stuck in a bunker with your in-law, with your family for 6 months. I mean, because what if they do show up? You got to say, no, you got to get out of here. Of course, she's not going to like that. And no matter how shady they are, that's her family. You know, and that's something you got to think about before you get married. I know I've said that, you know, guys probably shouldn't get married, or at least I don't see any sense for a guy to get married. Although, like Tom Likas, I also see a benefit for children. If you want to have children, then it makes sense for a guy to want to get married and have the kids within that institution. But you still got to, people still have to use common sense. And unfortunately, people don't put a lot of vetting in the whole process of choosing a wife or choosing a husband. You know, if you're a woman and you like to live and you like the amenities of a bigger city, and you enjoy living in the city or around the city, the suburbs, and you're with a guy who's from a town with, like, I don't know, 2,000 people, you got to find out if he really liked living in that town. Maybe he moved to a bigger city because he got tired of that slow pace, that lifestyle. He wanted more things. He wanted more access to things, concerts, museums, performances. Maybe he just didn't want to have to drive 40 minutes to go to Walmart, you know. Or you also got to see if he just moved out to get a job. Maybe he's just looking for a job or trying to get some experience or something. You know, he may want to move back. That's something that, you know, you might want to keep in mind. You may not want to move back. You may not have any experience living in a small area like that. You may find out that you like the slower lifestyle, but you may also decide that you don't like it. So, you know, people have to really think about that stuff. It's more than just, okay, how are we going to raise our kids? Which religion? Are we going to have a religion? And all this other stuff. And, you know, who's going to, all the logistics and everything. It's amazing. And, you know, people, they don't do credit checks on one another. They don't do blood tests or check for diseases, possible problems on the road. They don't do blood tests or check for drugs. You know, you never know. You may be marrying somebody who's hooked on heroin. I mean, that'll be one hell of a situation to put yourself into and not really know. Ideally, once you get married or once you decide you want to marry somebody, you know them well enough so that you don't have to worry about stuff like that. But you never know. Love, when people are in love, they sort of ignore some really big red signs. So that's why I think it's important to get a family's perspective. I don't understand why people decide they want to get married. They say, oh, let's get married, and then they introduce each other to the family, and then they sort of tell the family, oh, we're getting married, and then, you know, I mean, come on. You know, maybe you should, maybe it might not hurt getting family perspective, but then again, your family could be crazy. That's another thing, too. You know, if there's a bunch of criminals in that person's family, in that girl's family, and she's always hanging out with them, you got to understand, if you have kids, there's going to be, that element is always going to be around your kids. They're always going to be influencing your kids. So that's something you got to think about as well. So it's a lot of stuff people have to really think about. So I don't know. I mean, what do you guys think when it comes to getting married? What are some of the things that people just overlook? The credit check, for crying out loud. Okay, I think if somebody doesn't want to pay their debts, that says a lot about their character. That's another thing I agree with Tom Likas on. But beyond that, I mean, you can find yourself in a situation in a lot of states where you have to pay for a lot of that debt. And I know a lot of people are going to say, oh, no, that's just that person's debt. Hey, look, I know people who have been married and had to deal with the debt situation themselves. They married somebody with a whole lot of debt, with somebody who really liked to go shopping, really liked to pick up stuff. But typically when someone has a whole lot of debt, they tend to marry another person who thinks just like they do. And they tend to have a lot of debt as well. But who knows? I mean, what about student loans? Do you consider that to be an acceptable style of debt? I mean,